Hello, biology people. This screencast is going to be about the costs and benefits of sexual reproduction. We're going to discuss what it is, why it works, and also why we do it. However, before we can talk about sexual reproduction, we need to talk about this term, evolution. Evolution is the change in gene distribution and frequency over time. When we talk about over time, we're talking over many, many generations. Ultimately, this is going to lead to an increase in diversity at every level of biological organization. The more diversity you have, the better a chance your offspring have of surviving, particularly in an environment that happens to be constantly changing. We'll come back to this in a few minutes, but keep this in mind as we start talking about sexual reproduction. Let's begin by reviewing some differences between mitosis and meiosis. So we're going to start over here on the left with mitosis. Mitosis occurs in almost all of the cells in your body, with the exception of sex cells. In mitosis, one cell produces two exact copies of itself. Essentially, these two are clones. Inside the nucleus of a human body cell, you have 46 chromosomes. These 46 chromosomes are divided into 23 different pairs. Because we have 23 pairs of cells, we call this a diploid cell, which is also indicated by the symbol 2n. In mitosis, one diploid cell is going to duplicate itself to form two diploid cells. Remember that it duplicates its genetic material to avoid losing some of it when it divides in half. Meiosis also starts with a diploid cell, 23 pairs of chromosomes. However, after meiosis occurs, we now have four daughter cells, each of which are called haploid, meaning they have 23 single chromosomes, and we use the symbol N or 1N to indicate that they are haploid. Remember also that these cells are all going to be genetically diverse from one another. Let's zoom in on this set of cells a little bit more closely. So let's imagine that we have two haploid sex cells. We have a sperm cell and an egg cell. Now ignore the fact that the sperm cell and the egg cell here appear to be the same size. Generally speaking, the egg is significantly bigger but also less mobile. Each of these cells are haploid, meaning that they have 23 chromosomes. I did all of them in blue except for this red one in the bottom corner right down here. And the reason that this is red is because this is going to be the unusual chromosome. In an egg cell, this cell is always what we call an X chromosome. But in a sperm cell, it can be either X or Y. Depending on which variety of the 23rd chromosome this particular sperm cell have, it will determine whether or not the resulting zygote is going to be male or female. If the sperm cell has an X chromosome as the 23rd chromosome, the resulting zygote will be female. If it's a Y chromosome, however, the resulting zygote will be male. Let's now imagine that fertilization has occurred and the sperm and egg have united to form one zygote. This zygote is going to be diploid. It has one set of chromosomes from the mother and one from the father, meaning that you now have two of each variety of chromosome. This zygote would ultimately be male because it has an X and a Y chromosome for the 23rd pair. Each of the varieties of chromosome will line up with the corresponding chromosome from the other contributing parent. These are called homologous pairs. Each of these chromosomes is going to contribute one set of traits from the mother and one set of traits from the father. This is why you don't ever wind up looking or behaving exactly like one of your parents, because each chromosome is going to bring a different version of the same different kind of characteristic. These light blue chromosomes, for instance, might encode how tall you end up being, but you're probably not going to wind up being exactly the same height as either of your parents because we're going to be combining the different height genes from your mother and your father. Remember also that before you combine your chromosomes with another individual's, Each of your chromosomes in your sex cells are going to be slightly different from one another. So every cell that you produce is going to have a slightly different version of each of these chromosomes. So now we have to ask ourselves what all of these details have to do with asexual versus sexual reproduction. And we also want to remind ourselves that about 90% of all eukaryotic organisms are going to undergo sexual reproduction at some point during their reproductive cycle. So there must be some benefits to doing reproduction in this way. When an individual cell or an organism reproduces asexually, all of its offspring are going to be clones of the parent organism or the parent cell. Since all of the organisms are going to have exactly the same genetic code, this works really well in a static environment where things aren't changing very often. If the environment isn't going to change and your genetic code has worked really well for you, there's no reason to expend the extra energy to change your genetic code if things are already working out really well for you. However, if your environment is changing pretty frequently, you run the risk of having your exact cloned offspring die if the environment changes to something that's less suitable. Another major perk of reproducing asexually is that the energy expenditure is extremely low. You don't need to produce specialized gamete cells like eggs and sperm, you don't need to be pregnant, and you don't need to take care of your offspring after they've been created. Finally, you also don't need to find a mate if you don't reproduce with another organism. This is beneficial in a number of different ways because you don't need to develop attractive characteristics. And you also don't need to go find a mate, which is very helpful in low population areas where organisms are really far apart. However, not reproducing with a mate can also be a disadvantage because you have pretty much any organism that is healthy enough to reproduce reproducing, not just the absolute strongest, best organisms. And so overall, your population is going to stay a lot more varied in terms of how fit the organisms actually are. The biggest advantage of reproducing using sexual reproduction is that it introduces variability into the population. Before you even combine your gametes with that of another organism, your gametes are going to have different genes than you yourself have because of the way that meiosis works. Between the processes of crossing over and homologous recombination, all of your gametes are going to have slightly different genetic codes than you have, even though they came from you. Combining with another organism also leads to still more variation, leading into a greater variety and greater diversity of organisms in a population. Now, diversity is not always going to be good. You're going to have some combinations of genes that make the organisms less healthy and less fit, but you also have a chance at producing better organisms over time. This is a huge advantage in an environment that happens to be pretty variable. For instance, if a pathogen came along that was really dangerous to a certain kind of organism, you have a chance to get around that pathogen if you have a slightly different genetic code. But if all of your organisms are clones, unfortunately, if one of them is vulnerable, every single one is vulnerable. Because there are so many more changes happening from generation to generation with sexual reproduction, the rate of evolution actually increases. Remember that evolution is blind and it occurs without a goal in mind, so some changes that occur might actually be disadvantageous, while some other changes might actually be advantageous. This is going to result in a much more rapid accumulation of genes that increase the fitness of an organism. For the purposes of evolution, we define the word fitness as the ability to do two things. Number one is to survive, and number two is to reproduce. If you think about it, an organism is not useful at all if it doesn't survive long enough in order to pass along its genes. In addition, when you reproduce using sexual reproduction, you tend to get better quality offspring that are more well-equipped in order to survive. However, this is definitely a trade-off because organisms that reproduce sexually tend to have fewer offspring, and it also takes much longer. In addition to the time demands of finding a mate and maintaining the characteristics that are necessary to attract the mate, it also tends to require a much greater investment in terms of time and energy, even after the gametes have been combined. The more complex an organism is, the more likely it is that they will spend a long time taking care of their offspring after they've been reproduced. If you're going to spend a lot of time taking care of your offspring, you can only have a small number because each one of them places great demands on your time. However, if you're going to produce clones of yourself, generally speaking, those offspring don't need to spend a lot of time growing up and needing care. Okay, that pretty much wraps up the asexual reproduction versus sexual reproduction chat, and I will see you all in class.